Learn about different size classes, building a widget UI, and deep linking into your app in this lesson. Hey Code Crew, this is Flo. In the first lesson of this WidgetKit course, you learned about how WidgetKit works under the hood, how widgets are refreshed, and everything that Xcode automatically generates for you. In lesson 2, we will have a look at building UIs for different size classes and deep linking into the main app from the widget. Let's get right into it. So, we're starting in this lesson right where we left off in the last lesson. And actually, we don't need the content view. What we need is our widget definition here. So, I already told you in the first lesson that there are different size classes that your widgets can have. So, that's the first thing that we will have a look at in this lesson. To have a look at the size classes, configure them, and tell the system which size classes your widget supports, you can just go to your static or your intent configuration, basically just your widget configuration, and then there is a very simple modifier called supported families. Here you can just pass in an array of all of the widget families that you want to support. One note though is that the system extra large family is only available for iPad apps, since it cannot even fit on an iPhone. For this lesson, we will focus on system medium, which is basically two rows of apps at full width, and also system large, which is four rows of apps, so almost the entire screen taken up by that widget. While we're at it, let's also change the configuration name to my to-dos, and let's also change the widget description. Both of these strings are shown in the widget preview when the user wants to add a widget to their home screen. So, for example, here for a description, we could say, view your latest to-dos. Just like this. Okay, so now we have told the system that our widget supports both the system medium and the system large widget family. But now we have to actually implement both of these size classes. And what we will do is we will switch on the size classes that we can reach from the environment and then provide different views to the widget based on which size class is currently selected. For that, there is an environment value that we can read. So just say add environment. And then the key path is widget family. And this way we can basically read the size of the widget. And what we can now do is just switch over this because it's an enum. You just saw us set it up here in the supported families modifier. Just switch over it and then present different views. So here, let's remove the text and let's say switch widget family. And now we're only interested in two cases because we only support system medium and system large. So let's say dot system medium. And let's also say dot system large. And as always, a switch must be exhaustive in Swift, meaning that either we have to cover all of the cases individually, or we need to provide a default case in the end that should happen if none of the other cases holds true. In our case, or in a place like this, the default case will never be executed because we told the system that we only support medium and large. But nevertheless, we need to provide a default case. So let's just say not implemented here. And then we can forget about this. For the system medium and the system large cases, we will now implement widget UIs. So I will just hit command N, say new Swift UI file. And let's call the first one medium size view. Make sure that it's a member of the widget extension and not of the main app. Hit create. And then let's do the same with a large size view. For both of these, let's move them into a group over here in the widget just so we can separate everything. So let's call this group views. And in here, let's move our widget view, our large size view, and our medium size view. Okay, let's close these and open them up again. Let's start with the medium size view. First of all, we will want to receive a timeline entry, the one that our widget view already got from the timeline. and we will want to forward that into our medium size view. So to work with timeline entries, we need to import WidgetKit. And then over here, we just need to say we want to take in an entry, and we can either say provider.entry, or we can just directly tell Xcode the type, which is simple entry. Let's do the exact same thing for the large size view. So import WidgetKit, and then let's add a var entry of type simple entry. And actually, since we're inside of WidgetKit, we don't even need the previews here, so we can just scrap them from both of these views. That way Xcode won't complain about any issues. And now we can already start to add both of these views into our widget view. So for the system medium, let's just say medium size view with our entry, and then also large size view with our entry. Okay, for the medium size view, we will now start to implement the UI. And for that, I want to show you a pretty neat trick how to have at least a decently looking UI up pretty quick. For that, we will use a group box with a label. So a group box is basically just a wrapper around a bunch of views that groups them up and puts them into a box with some sort of grayish background. And with the label initializer here, we can pass in a label with a title and an image. In our case, we will use a system image. The title will be my to-dos, and the system image will be list.dash. And now inside of the group box, we can put our actual UI. So in our case, we will have an H stack here with first an image of a person. For that, we will use the SF symbol for person. Let's make that resizable. Let's make that scale to fit. And let's also give that a foreground color of secondary. So a nice grayish touch. Then let's add a little divider. So in case you didn't notice, you can place dividers in V stacks, but also in H stacks. And if you place them in H stacks, then they will be just a vertical line. And then in here, let's add a little V stack where we can display the contents of one of our to-do items. Let's give this a leading alignment like this. And then in here, we will have two text elements. The first one with the to-do title. Right now, we will just have some placeholder content here because we will fill out the timeline provider in the next lesson. Let's have this text as a headline font. So give this the font of .headline. And then below our title, we will have whether it is completed. So here, I will just say completed for now. We will fill this with a tiny bit of logic in the next lesson as well. And then here, we'll just say this is a subheadline like this. At the end, let's also add a spacer so everything is aligned nicely. And then let's also add some padding to the edge stack so nothing cuddles with the edges of the widget, I would say. Okay, that's the medium size view already done for this episode. Now let's move on to the large size view. In here, let's also remove the text and let's replace it with a V stack. Basically, what we want is we want to have kind of like a notepad feel to this widget. You already saw it in the first lesson, how it will look in the end, and let's implement that right now. First of all, there's this little header row at the top. I will give that a spacing of 16. And in here, let's add a little title called my to-dos. Then let's add the current date. So date.now with the format of date time. This is a very handy text initializer here where you can pass in a date and then it will be formatted nicely. And then let's push all of that to the leading edge. To format this a bit nicer, let's give it 8 points of padding. Let's give it a blue background. Let's give it a white foreground color to have a nice contrast to our blue background. Let's clip all of this so it's handled as a single view, because now we will apply a shadow with a radius of 5 points. If we were to not apply the clip modifier like this, then the shadow would be applied to each individual subview of our H stack. But we only want the shadow once for the entire H stack, so we need to clip everything into a single view. Okay, next up, we want to display a list of all of the currently open to-dos or all of the currently available to-dos. For that, we will create a for each. And for now, we will just feed this with random numbers. We will not even use them. So we will just say underscore in because we don't even care about these numbers. In the for each, let's create an H stack with a circle. This will basically be the indicator if the to-do is already completed or not. And here, actually, we don't need to say ID. We need to say self as the identifier. We don't want the full circle. We only want to stroke its border. So we will say stroke with a line width of 2. Let's scale this a little bit with a frame of 30 by 30. We don't care about the alignment since it's just a single circle. And then let's overlay something here. We want to overlay basically a little check mark if the to-do is already completed. So we will say if true for now, since all of this is just mocked. If true, we will have an image with the system name of checkmark. Okay, so that's the first part of our rows. Next, we want to add the to-do title. Okay, and then let's push everything to the leading edge with a spacer. Let's give this whole thing a bit of horizontal padding. And then also add a divider underneath. Okay, now that we have implemented both the large and medium size view, let me run them on the simulator and show you how they look. Okay, so the simulator is now running and you can already see our medium size widget here. So all of this is a group box. Up here you can see our label that we added at the bottom here. Then there's this scaled system image, the to-do title, and that it is already completed. And if we swipe over to the next side, we see a tiny bit of an issue with our large size view, and that is because we have too many lines or too many cells here. So let's reduce that to 6 and run it again and have a look. Okay, this is already looking a lot better. So we have our header here. The only thing that I forgot to do is to add a little spacer below our for each, so we don't have that white space at the top there. So let's add the spacer here. Let's run this one last time. Okay, and there you can see now the UI looks exactly how we wanted it. We have our header here with the blue background and a tiny bit of shadow at the bottom here, if you can even notice it. Then we have the title of my to-dos and the current date. And then, of course, we have our rows of our different to-do items. As you know, all of these are mocked right now. Okay, in the second part of this lesson, we will have a look at deep links. So basically, we want the user to be able to tap somewhere on the widget and then open up a specific piece of information inside of the app. To achieve that, there are a few steps that we need to take. First of all, we need to set up the target URL in our widgets using either the widget URL modifier on the entire UI or using specific link views, for example, for our rows here inside of the for each. And then we also need to handle the onOpenURL modifier inside of the main app that basically handles what the app displays when it gets opened through a widget URL or any kind of deep link for that matter. First of all, we will have a look at the widget URL modifier because it's a tiny bit easier to use. For that, we just have to add it as the last thing in our medium size view. So the widget URL modifier, which needs a URL, and we will construct that right now from a string. I will tell you about this once we basically parse the URL in the main app, then you will see how all of this works. Basically, what I usually do as the scheme, I will just say the app name, so just my app in this case, colon slash slash, then the different routes basically. So here we'll have slash to do, slash, and then the identifier of a to-do, which we will later on get dynamically from our timeline provider. Right now, I will just hard code this to be 1. Okay, and that's already the widget URL modifier. This is all we have to add to our widget to open a specific thing inside of our app, or to at least tell the app so, because right now the app doesn't handle anything. Before we do that, let's have a look at the link view for our large size view. For that, we will grab our entire H stack here, copy it, and embed it in a link with a destination URL, and then as the label, we will just paste back in the H stack. And now you can already imagine this URL is basically the exact same thing as before, but the main difference is in the widget URL modifier, you can pass in an optional URL, which is happening here because the string initializer always gives back an optional URL. But in the link view, we need to pass in a non-optional URL, so we will have to false unwrap this here. In a real application, you might not want to do that. You might want to construct a URL at a different place, be sure that it exists, and then pass it into your view. For now, in here, we can basically put the exact same URL as we had in our medium size view. Once again, this identifier here is hard-coded right now. We will replace this with the identifier of that specific to-do item later on. All right, that's already everything that we need to set up in our two widget views. So we can close those up now, and we have to move into our main app in our content view now. We will now have to add the onOpen URL modifier at the end of our content view here. And this basically gives us a closure passing in the URL that the app caught when it was opened from a URL. This is basically not called when the app is launched regularly. This is only called in our case if the app is launched through the widget. So if the user tapped on the widget, then this closure here will get called. And now our task is it to parse the URL, make sure that it's in the correct format, download the data that we want to display, and then display that data. So first of all, let's make sure that this URL is correct. So we will have to check if the scheme is correct. And the scheme in our case needs to be my app. So if we one last time go back into one of our views, the scheme is basically this right here. In a web URL, this would be HTTPS, for example. Next up, we will have to check that the host is todo, url.host equals to todo. That's basically this route that I mentioned before. And then lastly, we need to extract the identifier. So let's say let ID equals an int from our URL's path component number one. So let's just say path components at the position one. And that will be the number here at the very end, which we hard coded right now, but will then be filled in from our actual to-dos. Now that we have all of that, let's make sure that in case any of this is not working, we will just return out of the closure and do nothing. You can also print that there is an issue here in case you want to debug it somehow. Okay, now we have everything that we need. Basically, that's just the ID. Both of these are just error checks. Now, I've already told you about this in the first lesson. We will use the get to do function of our to do servers. I've told you that this is using the new Swift concurrency features and that it is an asynchronous function that can throw errors, but in the end returns us a single to do with that identifier that we pass into the function. So let's use that. And since we're not in an asynchronous context, we need to first of all create a task. I already told you this function can fail, so we need to wrap it in a do catch block. And then for now, we will just print the error. But in reality, you should handle the error in an adequate way. Now let's get to the meat. So we want to download our to-do from our service. So let's say let to-do equals try to await. All of this with concurrency stuff. We already talked about this in the first lesson. If you want to learn more about this, just check the Swift concurrency lessons. They will be linked down below. So we will try to await the to-do service. We have a shared instance here the getToDo function with the identifier that we extracted out of the URL here. So let's just pass in that ID. Once that finishes, once the await is done, basically, we need to switch back to the main queue because this can happen in any queue. And now we want to update our UI, so we need to be on the main queue for that. And if you remember from the first lesson, we have this state of the selected to-do here. And if we set that to a to-do, then a sheet will be shown with information about that to-do. So we can just say selected to-do equals our to-do that we just loaded with our getToDo function. Okay, this was a lot of talking, a lot of code. Let's run it in a simulator and see how it works. Okay, so first of all, let's have a quick look at the WidgetKit Calls app here. Okay, everything still looks good. Now let's have a look at the medium-sized widget. Remember, we added the widget URL modifier here, so you can tap anywhere inside of the widget. Then the app will open up and it will tell us all of the information about the to-do with the identifier 1, because that's what we always passed in here as a hard-coded identifier. And then if we close that again, go to the home screen, and now over here in the large size widget, you will have to have a very, a sharp eye here. If you click on the individual cells, then they will get highlighted a tiny bit like a button and the app will get open. So let me click on the third cell here. You saw there was that little subtle button click animation. Now the app opened again and we once again see information about the to-do number 1 because that's just what we hard coded. Okay, so in this lesson you learned about different size classes in widgets and how to show different UI components for those. You also learned about deep links using widget URL, link, and on open URL in the main app.